Somebody just shout hallelujah. Somebody just give God some praise. Hallelujah. It is a wonderful thing to give thanks unto God and to sing praises unto his name, O Most High. Would you stand to your feet with me this morning? Hallelujah. As we raise up our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords, we thank God for sending his Son, Jesus Christ, into the world so that today we can rejoice with exceeding a great joy. Hallelujah. Because we serve a wonderful Savior. We serve the Savior of the world. Hallelujah. Let us lift our voices as we sing. Christians awake, salute the happy morn, whereon the Savior of the world was born. Hallelujah.
Christians awake, salute the happy morn, whereon the Savior of the world was born. Rise to adore the mystery of love,
To just lift up our King. Hallelujah. Eternal Hallelujah. Praise to heaven's almighty King. A joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and the nature sing. Hallelujah. Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive. Make us sing and shout this morning. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nation prove the glories of his righteousness. Hallelujah. We serve an amazing Savior this morning. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn. Joyful on the nation's joy, join the triumph of the sky, wind and jealous, host proclaim. Hallelujah. Adam's likeness now we face. Stamp thine image in its place. Second Adam from above reinstate us with thy love. What powerful lyrics. Hallelujah. That was penned by that writer. Hallelujah. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem. Shining afar through shadows dim, giving the light to those who long have gone. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through shadows dim, giving the light to those who long have gone. And guiding the wise men on their way, unto the place that Jesus led. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine. Jesus is now the star divine, and brighter he will shine. So we come and worship. We worship Christ, the newborn King. He's worthy of our worship this morning. Hallelujah. Only he alone deserves it. Hallelujah.
Angels from the realms of glory, wave your light, oh holy God.
We bless the Lord. Let us pray. Indeed, God, we've come to give you all of our worship. There is none like you. Absolutely none like you. We thank you, God, that even in this season, as we think of your gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, we just come in adoration. Because Jesus, at a time when we were not even thinking about you, you took on our sins. You came as a babe. You fulfilled the mission. And you went to the cross just for us. We can't even think of how we can worship you. You are marvelous. You are majestic. You are sovereign. You are our keeper. You are our healer. You are the one who spoke and it came into being. You are the one who stretched the sky from one point to another. You are the one who caused the sea to just come to a point and stop. You are the one who gives us the very air that we breathe. God, we cannot even see it. We just see the swaying of the trees. You are just oh so awesome. We worship you. We adore you. We lift you up. We thank you, Jesus, that you are indeed the light of this world. God, we were in darkness and your light shone. And oh, what a marvelous light. Thank you for your love. Thank you, God, that you love us in spite of us. Thank you that you love every one of us. And it is with a heart of thanksgiving that we come together at this time in your sanctuary and everywhere else on social media, everywhere, God. We just come together, God, to give you glory. You deserve the glory. You deserve the honor. All power belongs to you. And so we worship and we adore you. We thank you for giving us this privilege, God, of coming to you. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for ministering to us. You have kept us. Even when we were uncertain, you knew that today would come. You knew that we'll be at this point in time. And so, God, we thank you so much. We thank you, God, that even our very tears you do understand. And God, in those moments when we were beside ourselves, you were with us. You have never left us. You have never forsaken us. And so, God, when we jump and we rejoice, it is just because of who you are. Because of who you are, we give you glory. Because of who you are, we give you praise. There is none like you, mighty God. We thank you, God, for this moment that we can also hear from you. We thank you that your voice makes the difference. We thank you, God, that in the midst of the chaos, you speak to us in a still, small voice. We thank you, God, that in the midst of the merrymaking, we can take time out to just listen to you. We thank you for this opportunity, God. And as the songs go up, as the word is read, as the word is being proclaimed, even as you speak to us outside of that, because Holy Spirit, you have a way of working. We might be here and something is happening at one side, but you just direct our gaze towards you. You speak into our being and you minister. So we thank you for this moment of deliverance. We thank you, God, that it is at this time that some of us will realize that the shackles have been broken. We have carried them along. We have walked as if we are lame, not recognizing that you came and you did it for us. So God, for those of us who will recognize today that the shackles have been broken, help us to walk in that liberty. Help us to walk in that freedom. Thank you, God, that you are the comforter. For those of us, God, who are grieving and who are burdened, you are our burden bearer. We thank you, mighty God, that it is already lifted. So help us, God, that we can just turn it all over to you. We thank you that you have already taken it. Thank you, God, that you are such a proactive God. You have done everything for us, God, every single thing that we need, God. You have already done it, and you have provided. Thank you, God, for the new life. Because even as we focus and as we think of how you came, there is also new life for us. Thank you, Jesus, that today there is an opportunity for someone to become a babe in Christ. We thank you that you are still in the business of saving people. So God, today we give you thanks and we rejoice with the angels as persons will come out of darkness into this marvelous light. We thank you, God, that your kingdom will be advanced. We thank you that your gospel will be proclaimed, this life-transforming gospel. And God, that someone today will see Abba, Father. We thank you for your love. We thank you, God, that you are such a gracious Father. You provide for us. You guide us. You chasten us. And God, even when we walk away from you, you are looking out for us. And when we return to you, oh, what a party you put on for us. God, we thank you for the celebration. We thank you for those who are returning home today. Help us, God, to embrace them. And God, as we hush in your presence, we surrender all to you. All to Jesus, I surrender. We make it personal, God. We make a personal commitment to you. God, we walk away from stiff-neckedness. Those times, God, when you have spoken to us and we have walked away, we ask your forgiveness. God, we have made things our idols. We have pledged allegiance to things that are not godly. And we humbly confess before you. We thank you for this moment of reflection and for looking ahead. We do not know what the future holds, but we know him who holds the future. It is such a joy, God, to know you. Trustworthy God, we put everything into your care. And as we hush, God, speak, Lord. Speak to us, Lord. In the stillness, speak to us, God. You are an individual God. You see every last one of us. You know us by name and by nature. And so, God, we humbly bow before you. We need a word from you. If we do not hear from you, Lord, we do not know what to do. Thank you, God, that we can trust you. We give you honor. We give you glory. We thank you, Lord. This is a day that is different. This is a day when you have called us to pay attention. Today is not a day to look at anyone else. Today is a day that you will speak to us as individuals. We give you glory. Thank you, God, for speaking. Thank you, God, for answering prayers. Thank you, God, for delivering. Thank you, God, for restoring joy. Thank you for healing. Thank you, God, for just being you. For just being consistent. For never changing, for never lying, for being a covenant keeper. Thank you, God. We acknowledge you, Father, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Somebody give God praise. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. Shout hallelujah to the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, this is the last Sunday of 2021. Amen. And so we give God thanks. There are how many more days? Five? Five more of this year? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday?
Yes.
Yeah, and how many days in a year? 365, so this is the 360th day. All right. So how many of you thought somewhere along the line in 2021 that you would either be dead, you would have lost your mind, lost your house, lost your kids, lost your family, lost your joy, lost your hair, you would have pulled out all your hair, you would have gone over the other end, you would have just flipped out. Listen, there's a thin line between sane and insane, eh? Yeah. So those of you who still sane, you better give God thanks that you're sane. There's a thin line. And there are some things and some people, things and people. And listen to me carefully, I ain't gonna say no devil. Sometimes we give the devil credit. I understand the devil is there and all of them. There are some people, don't tell me not about no devil. People that you intentionally hang out with, and they have been bad for you.
Yeah.
And 2021 coming to an end, and God has delivered you from them.
Hallelujah.
Your enemy can't do anything because your enemy don't know nothing about you. You keep all your business from your enemy. If anybody gonna stab you in your back is your friend, then know where you don't walk. They know where your key be. They know everything.
Yes.
But what a mighty God we serve.
Hallelujah.
Amen. If it had not been for the Lord on our side, then where would we have been? What a mighty God we serve. Now I want us to sing that chorus because today is normally like our stock-taking Sunday. So don't be in a rush to go nowhere. Your belly is still full from yesterday. You don't need no more food. You need to fast today. Those of you who didn't eat yesterday, it's not my fault that you plan to eat today. But we are gonna sing and worship. God has been good. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God. Lift your voice, sing that song, amen.
Somebody singing, what a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. It's a love before it, never had a glory. What a mighty God we serve.
What a
I have a right to shout.
I have a right to shout.
You may be seated, please. He indeed woke us up this morning, and every day of this past year, what a mighty God. Amen. What a mighty, mighty God. Amen. Yes, sir. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. We welcome those of you who are with us. We are so happy that we can be together like this, and we give God praise. We thank God for those who are joining us via social media and other various means. We welcome you. Those of you who have been with us over the past year, we want to thank you very much. Many of you in the diaspora and other areas, you have been with us and you have contributed online, and we are so pleased for that. And we also appreciate your prayerful support and your moral support, your encouragement. There are many across our federation. Thank you for joining us. You only need to walk Bastion. I meet people all the time and tell me they listen in Deer Bay, St. Paul's, Old Road, all over. And we give God thanks that this message of the kingdom is getting out. Amen. So that's why I tell us, when we come to church, I know people like to say church need to be jiggy and all kind of words they use. No. Church is not entertainment. Church is not a club. I'm sorry. Church is different. When you go to Best Buy and Rams and the grocery store, you expect them to have groceries in there. You don't expect them to have lumber. You expect them to have groceries. That's what they sell. That's what you go there for. When you want lumber, you go to TDC, Hartsford and Builders. When you want your soul to be charged, you come church. Amen. So when you come church, church ain't about no club. You want club and pretty lights spinning around, you go club. When you come church, you come to hear the word of God. Amen. And we don't do club here, we do church. Amen. Amen. God is good. You see, because what the church has to offer, you can't get it no place else. Your soul must be fed. Your soul must be challenged. Your spirit man must be spoken to. And that is the job of the church. Even if it dwindles off, it's okay. That's the job of the church. And the church must constantly and always do that. That is the role. When you come to church, you don't be on the phone. You young people, you get off your phone. We look across sometimes, see young people on phone. If your friends respect you, they should know this is your church time. And you don't have nothing to post. We have a media ministry. Whatever we want to post, we post in it. You don't need to post nothing. You young people, you get off your phones. In the new year, you come here with phone. We have a basket outside. Pick up all those phones from you. When you finish, you take them and go with them. We don't want nobody on the phone. You come to church, you focus. Because you don't understand. You are a distraction to the minister. You are a distraction to the praise people. You are a distraction. When we look out there and see you on phone, you distract us. On your job, some of you can't have no phones. You can't even carry it with you. You can't even pee in your bag. So when you come into the house of God, no phones. We got to get serious about this thing. So you young people, no phones. Don't want to see anybody looking down on any phones. I'll call you out. You are distracting me. I'm very serious. I'm not joking at all. I'm not joking at all. You come to church, you listen to the word of God. You wanted to hang out with your friends? Stay out of church and hang out with them. You come to church, you listen to the word of God. And part of our challenge is, when you go home, you don't quiz your children. We were quizzed. So you grew in the things of God. What did you learn today? What did that mean to you? That is important. Very, very important. So young people, no phones, please. You get serious here now. I want to speak to you briefly this morning and challenge your hearts. And I want to speak to you on this thought. It's not a subject, but it's just a theme for you to appreciate. No matter what people tell you, I want you to understand this. That God's vision for your life can only fail if you stop believing. God's vision for your life can only fail if you stop believing. And I want us to understand something, because we live in a time when we are not willing to appreciate God's big purpose and his work in the world. I want you to understand this, that God has a purpose and a direction for his world. God has an intention for his world and his creation. And God operates in time in relation to his creation. I know that this year some of us have been through some very difficult things in our lives. And the tendency is to think that, well, God, why me? And I can't imagine that this is happening, and I, this is just too much for me. God has a big purpose for His creation. Where you found yourself this year is part of the big plan of God. What transpired in your life this year is part of the big plan. And I hear somebody saying, Pastor, really? Yes. You see, the culture has taught us that we should get what we want when we want it. Did you hear me? The culture has taught us we should get what we want when we want it. And that's the kind of culture we live in. As soon as we don't get what we want, we are done. We quit. How many of you quit this year? Quit on your family. Quit on your church. Quit on your parents. Quit on your friends. You quit. I'm done. I give up. I stop. As soon as we don't get what we want, we quit. Yes, sir. That is the kind of culture that we live in. As soon as you meet a bump in the road in your marriage, I'm done. You forgot those vows you made when you came to the altar and you say, for better or for worse. Yes, sir. The doctor just tell you something. You ain't even hear from another doctor. You give up on life. You're gone home. You lock down your house. Close down your windows. You're not telling anybody anything. And I want to challenge you people. That there are, you're going to hear a testimony this morning. And there are people who God has sent in your life to encourage you. Don't be selfish with your sickness. Don't be selfish with your sickness. Don't be selfish with your sickness. Because sometimes, not every time, but sometimes it is pride. That you don't want to tell anybody that this shouldn't happen to you. You can't believe this has happened. You don't have the money and all those things. It's pride. You don't want anybody to see you coming down, losing your muscles, your skin sagging, walking with a cane. You don't want to see anybody come to visit you and you are curled up in your bed. It's pride. There are people God has placed in your life to encourage you. Man, you've walked with them all of your life. They've been your friends. They've been your drinking buddies, your church prayer partners, whatever they were to you. And now that you need them, some one of them will show up. You don't just give up on life. You don't just give up on life. You don't hold everything from your children. You don't tell your children anything. You're going to suffer in silence. You have nothing to say to anybody. That's not good. The culture has taught us a lot of bad things. Because you see, that comes from the sense that we think nobody cares. Because you know what we say sometimes? People ask you how you do. You said, I'm good. She said, it doesn't matter if you tell them that you're not doing well because nobody really cares and it doesn't really matter to anybody. That's not true. That's not true. You know, God has a tremendous family tree. And one of the things, I'm going to say something right now that's going to shock some of you. One of the things that I want you to understand, that there are even people who you don't consider people of God. You don't consider them Christian. You don't consider them all those things. And they are wonderful people. And God sometimes put them in your way to bless you. Sometimes in your most difficult circumstances of life. These are people who you say, oh, they don't know God and they're no Christian. And God uses them in tremendous ways. And it's time that we begin to appreciate and understand the vastness of our God. We can find God to what we want Him to be instead of who He is. The vastness of our God. And more I'm learning to appreciate. Boy, God, you got a sense of humor. I don't know how and why you set up these kind of things. But I don't know about you. But I know that this year, the Lord has orchestrated some things Even days when you didn't feel like, you know, sometimes you got to be transparent. You didn't want to talk to that person. You ever feel like that? And that's the person who had the blessing. And when you don't talk to them, you say, "But boy, if God hasn't orchestrated anything in your life this year, He can do it for you next year. But God works out some things. Put some people right in your way. As soon as you ask a question, they say, 'I know somebody. I know a situation. I know how that can be done. I know where you can go. I know how to get that sorted out.'" Yes, sir. If you follow God's vision for your life, it cannot fail. It only fails if you stop believe. Now, quickly then, let me tell you this. In Galatians chapter number 4 and verse number 4, the Bible says this, that when the fullness of time was come, when the fullness of time, you should honor that in, underline that in your Bible. This passage is very important to me because I always look at it and think of how God operates when the fullness of time. You know, we were taught that nothing happens before its time. And in God's economy, when the fullness of time is come, this tells us that God operates in divisions of time. That there are predetermined, predestined times in the schedule of God. When the fullness of time was come. And even as we celebrate in this season, everything about this season, everything demonstrates that when the fullness of time was come. Sometimes it seems like God ain't saying nothing to you. You know, between the Old Testament and the New Testament, they tell us there was 400 years and God ain't said a word. No prophet spoke, no angels visit, nobody said nothing. God didn't say a word. Because God had already spoken through the prophets. And after that 400 years, the angel visited, Gabriel visited Mary and gave Mary the greeting. And Mary was so afraid because when angels came, generally it was about destruction. But when God's timing was right and God aligned and orchestrated that Mary would bring forth the Son of God, He had to go through all of the processes and bring her. You know, sometimes in our own life, why things are not working out for us is because we are not committing ourselves to God, that we are part of God's big plan. We want to do things the way we want to do it. And then there is another set of us who just on the end of poor me. I am a nobody. Oh, nobody care. Oh, this is it. My life is done. Poor me. Let me tell you something. You have a God who bent down, who formed you, who created you, who take a look off and say, straighten up that nose a little bit. Make that lip a little thicker. Make those hair a little longer. Make those legs a little shorter. Let me tell you something. It doesn't matter what people say about you. God created you for His purpose. We have allowed the situations of the world to change what God has brought and restored and done for us and taught us through His word. And so God says, in that predetermined time, I am going to do my work. This year was the time for many things in your life. Some of you got married. That was God's time. I pray that you sought Him carefully. Because if that was God's time and God intends that, let me tell you something. You ain't supposed to visit no courthouse. There are far too many Christian marriages today before the courthouse. Something has to be wrong with that. Something has to be wrong with that. How is it that as people of God, you can't get along? Something has to be wrong with that. I say no more and I move on. But there are good things that happened in your life this year. What is it that God's timing is working on your behalf? Even in COVID, some of you saved more money. Some of your businesses are doing better in COVID-19. Some of you finished your construction on your homes. You graduated from university. You moved on. You have done tremendous things this year. Some of you have waited and waited and waited, and you are still waiting. God works on a timetable. When His time is right, He will bring it to pass. So let me tell you this. In Genesis chapter 15, verses 12 to 16, make a note of this quickly. God said to Abraham, your people are going to be in slavery for over 400 years. And afterwards, I'm going to deliver them, and I'm going to punish those who kept them in slavery. Now, this is what God says to Abraham, even before the children of Israel were in slavery down in Egypt. Fast forward. Over 400 years, the children of Israel are in slavery, and God is ready to deliver them based on what He had already said to Abraham. That is why it's important for you to pass on to different generations what God has said, because what God said, He means. I suggested to you some time ago that God's word is His very act. What God says, you don't have to believe it for it to happen. Once God said it, it has already happened. It's just the time for you to see the manifestation. But God said, let there be light. And there was. What God says, His word is His act. In Exodus chapter number 12, after 400 years, the Bible says that God would speak to Moses and the children of Israel. And He says to them, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year unto you. Sanctify yourself. The Passover feast would take place and the children of Israel would leave Egypt. I just want to bring one thing to your attention. Because it took over 400 years for this word to be made manifest and to comfort what God had predetermined. You see, you have to recognize that you are not in the world on your own. You are in the world with your family, your friends, the people you come in contact with, on your job, and everybody you will meet. Because what God has deposited inside of you is not for yourself. It is for all of these people. What God has deposited in your family when you get children is for those children. That you are going to pass this down to them. So in your generation, you may not necessarily see the wealth, but your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren will see the wealth. And guess what happens? Because you also inculcated the word of God inside of them, they will bless the work of the Lord. And the work of God will continue in the earth. God has a very strange way of working. And we have to understand that when God is working, it's really not about us. It is all about God. And we must be happy that we are part of that plan that God has for His world. And so oftentimes we think about ourselves. Just what I want. What makes me happy. There are a lot of things in your life today will not make you happy. But you know what? They will make God smile. Because when God look at it, God see how it is making you into the person He wants you to be. And so it is, the word of God says, they would begin afresh. And in Psalm 106, I want to draw this to your attention then. The word of God says, Psalm 105 and verse 35, that when God brought them out, He says He brought them out with a strong hand, and there was not one feeble or sickly person among them. Now understand this. The children of Israel are in bondage for over 400 years. They have been through plagues. They have been through difficult taskmasters. They have been through sickness. They have been through affliction. And God is ready to deliver them. And as God delivers them, the word of God says that He's going to bring them out, and there was not one feeble person among them. Now understand that they are coming immediately on the heels of the 10 plagues. If you know anything about the 10 plagues, one of the things that they caused failed to let the children of Israel go was that the last plague was the killing of the firstborn. And the children of Israel would experience, they would see all of this. And you have elderly among them, patriots, old, young, everybody. And the word of God would say to us that there was not one feeble among them. Let me tell you this, my friends. When God is ready to bring you out, He transforms you. If you are on the side of God, then God has infused life into you. God has infused his breath into you. God has infused his spirit into you. And where God's spirit is, he empowers you. No matter what it is that we have gone through in this past year, no matter what that affliction is, as we come to the end of this new year, I don't say to you that as you cross over into this year, God's willing by his grace and his mercy, that there is nothing that will come upon you that will hurt you. But I say this, like the children of Israel, they left all the memories behind until they came to a point where they realized that they thought God had forgotten them. But understand this, as you step forward into God's promises, he said you leave behind your bad memories, your poverty, your sickness, your disease, your affliction, everything that seeks to prevent you from moving forward. Because the truth is, my friends, if you do not change the way you think, your life will always be the same. And you can't just merely change the way you think. But St. Paul says you must transform your minds by the renewing of God's word and prove that which is perfect and pleasing unto him. And when you change the way that you think, your life begins to change. You see what God does when he comes into our life? God changes and he regenerates us. And when God regenerates you, you cannot be the same person. You are a new creation in Christ. So in your old life, you were oppressed, you were in bondage, you were afflicted, you were having hard taskmasters. But in your new life, God brings you out. God redeems you. God transforms you. God changes you. You look throughout the word of God, and everyone who God had an encounter with, their life was changed. Many of us have come every Sunday of this past year. And you know what? If we do a stock taking, our life is still the same. We've been through stuff, and in going through all of this stuff, we have refused to worship God. We have focused upon our own strength, our own self, what we wanted. And we have missed the point of God working in our life. We have accused God of being unfair to us. And you know, sometimes when you think about it, while every heart knows its own sorrow, you really have nothing to complain about. You have nothing to complain about. This past year, we have celebrated, mourned, prayed, walked, cried, and done so many things with one of our couples. And they demonstrate how the power of God in praise and worship can be made manifest in our life. And I want you to just listen to a brief testimony as they share their own experience and help you to appreciate that when you are walking in God's will, nothing can change that except you stop believing. Just hear what they have to say to us.
Greetings from Cali, Colombia.
Good morning, church. Good morning, Pastor. Season greetings from our family to yours.
Yes, season's greetings to everyone, and we are truly grateful for the opportunity to share in today's service, to give a bit of our testimony, our journey thus far, and how God has been good to us. And we trust and we believe that with God, all things are possible.
And as Marlon rightfully said, you know, with God, all things are possible, and I'm a living testimony of that. Just for those who don't know, just to give a little testimony of my journey thus far, in March of this year, I was diagnosed with breast cancer. Also, I was 8 months pregnant at the time, and it was a bittersweet because we were expecting our first child, mm-hmm. and then with the news that you have breast cancer, wasn't something that, you know, I was expecting at all.
Yes.
And I said, God, like, what's happening? Why is it that you give us these blessings and then now I'm diagnosed with cancer? You know, what is the purpose of this? And, you know, I questioned and I wanted to know why. Why this had happened at this time, at this joyous moment. But I said, you know what? God, you are in control. You know why. I don't, but you know why. And it so happens that during that time, it was also diagnosed that my cancer was a progressive type. And with that, I had to have an emergency C-section done to get Ethan out, because the cancer was progressing so fast.
Yeah.
I had to have a mastectomy 4 days after my C-section.
Yeah.
And it was a journey, because 2 major surgery within 1 week. It wasn't something that I was expecting. It wasn't something that I wanted, because yeah. I didn't want it to take the moment of my first child away, and it did at that time, because I was in so much pain.
Yeah.
And you know, this, you know, of sudden you have a newborn baby and you're going through all of this. But as I said, I trusted in God and I said, God, whatever your plan is, I hope that you're going to work it out, and you're going to show us and give us a direction, and you're going to set our path in which you want us to walk on. But it has been a tremendous blessing to have Ethan also, because if he did not arrive, I would not have known that I had breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
But I thank God that he put that for a reason, because it could have been worse.
Yes,
it could have been worse. I would not have been here. But as I said, God had a plan, and mm-hmm. we question it, but we don't know why, how, what. But he has a plan, and we just have to trust in him that he's going to make a way.
Yes.
And you know, my journey, as I said, was not easy. You know, the days with my cancer, I am in treatments and I'm in so much pain, and persons who have cancer will know how the pain goes. It's not anything I wish on anybody. It's very painful that sometimes, you know, sometimes when Marlon went back to St. Kitts and I was here with my family, I had my moments when I was like, just, what must I say? I cried so many nights because I'm in so many pain. And I chose to cry in the night because I didn't want anybody to see. Because I didn't want to put a burden on them. And then sometime a man will call and say, you're okay? I was like, yes, I'm okay. I also smile on my face. You see me, you'll never see me down. And if you do see me down, know that I was down because I was in so much pain. But I trusted in God that he's going to find a way to make everything right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, and we continue to trust in God. The journey to Colombia was not an easy one.
Yes.
It was recommended that we come here because of, firstly, the radiation. But after some tests were done, it was recommended that another set of chemo be done, because Jem did 3 rounds of chemo in St. Kitts.
But because of the cancer progression.
The cancer was aggressive and it came back. And so they recommended another round. So we're going to be here for an extended period until about maybe May. Yeah. And we were not planning for that.
Yeah, we were only scheduled to be here for one month.
Yes.
But as I said, when we got here, the news that, you know, because of the cancer and the progression, I needed to have 6 rounds of chemo, which is 6 months.
Yes.
And, you know, we didn't know how it was going to be possible.
Yeah.
Honestly, but we trusted and we
continue to trust in God.
Yeah, we had a good support team and pastor. The church has been a blessing to us during this time, and I just want to say thank you, pastor, so much. We appreciate you. We love you.
Yes.
We appreciate the church and all that has been done. You know, we just ask you guys to continue to pray for us.
Yes.
The journey is not over. Continue to pray for us. And we appreciate all of you. And my support team also, my girls, I just want to say good morning.
Yes, we really give God thanks for the support team. Mm-hmm. And I want to encourage someone who may be listening this morning to remember that if you're going through a trying period in your life, lean on someone. Find someone you can share with, to, you know, give you some encouragement, or if not for encouragement, just for them to listen. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes you need someone to speak to, and you just want them to sit there and just listen to you. And, you know, find someone whom you can speak with, and not just stay in silence, but share with someone.
And, and someone who can give you good advice.
Yes,
because you know, during that time, you don't want to have negativity, you want to have positivity, and that's what you want. So make sure you have somebody who can be there to give positive outcome, positive support to you, because it's very important.
Yes, yes. And then the other thing we want to share with you is to let you know that God's people are everywhere. When we speak about the church, we know as Christians, when we speak about the church, we speak about God's people.
Yes.
The people, we are the church. And during our journey, even leaving St. Kitts, traveling to Colombia, so many obstacles we've encountered. But for some miraculous reason, God has just placed his people in the right place.
Oh yes.
And it's been amazing how God has worked out his plan. And we want to give God all the praise for that. And to let you know that God's people are everywhere.
Yes.
It doesn't matter where you go in the world, no matter what language you speak, God's people are everywhere. And we have proven that. We have seen it. We have encountered it for ourselves. And we just want to give God thanks for that.
Indeed.
And then we want to also leave with you the final, you know, part of our journey is prayer.
Prayer.
It's been amazing
how prayer can do.
Supporting prayer has been pouring in from all over the world.
Yeah.
And we thank you, you know, Antioch, we thank you, Pastor, for your prayers.
Yes.
And we just want to encourage someone. If you're going through, again, if you're going through a difficult period, lean on someone, have a support team, and pray. Prayer is important. And you know, it's funny because even people who sometimes we think are not Christians, the first thing that they say, I will pray for you.
Yes.
I will pray for you. And that has been just an encouragement.
Yeah.
We covet your prayers. We have a long way to go, and we know that God is going to work his plan out.
Yes.
But we want to encourage, you know, that person who is going through a difficult period, just to lean on God, trust him, prayer, look to his people, and also find a support team. And we continue to lean on that, and we're encouraged by your outpouring of love towards us, and we will continue to be strong. We will not give up. And Jem will return to you with a thumbs up, and even though she lost her hair, she will come back stronger than before.
Indeed.
We thank you, we love you, and we want to just say Merry Christmas again. God bless you, and thank you.
Bye.
We want to thank Deacon Marlon and Sister Jem. And as we asked you last week, and we did in the 7 o'clock service already, we asked you to bring a special offering for Deacon Marlon and Sister Jem, and we are going to take that at this time, and Deacon Rommel will play a selection during the collection. So not your regular offerings or anything to do with your pledge. What you're putting in now is a love offering for Deacon Marlon and his wife. That's what you're giving right now. And whatever you give, we are going to match that as a church. And so we encourage you to give. If you give $20, we are going to put an extra $20. You give $100, put an extra $100. So Deacon Rommel is going to be playing, and we are going to get that song at this time as he shares and the ushers collect the offering for Deacon Marlon and his wife. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving. Thank you very much, Deacon Rommel. Indeed, a baby changes everything. If you're celebrating a birthday or anniversary, we want to celebrate with you. Those who are closing out the month of December in celebration. When your birthday is in December, it's a long time to wait. Seems like it would never come. Amen. So those who are celebrating, those are some from the 7 o'clock service. Stand if you're celebrating today, this week. Let's recognize you. It's Brother Ray's wedding anniversary. We want to celebrate with him. Have a birthday maker, birthday. I think it's Dwight's birthday. Brother Huggins and his wife, their wedding anniversary, Tricia's birthday. All right. So let's sing for those who are celebrating their birthdays.
A happy birthday to you. A happy birthday.
Remain standing. We're going to ask Sister Evan to ask the Lord's blessings on those celebrating their birthdays and anniversaries this week.
Father and our God, as we present our birthday and anniversary celebrants before you, we give you thanks, God. You have been mighty good to them.
Yes.
God, you have brought them this far. We thank you for your many blessings. God, you have watched over them. You have protected them. You have provided for them. God, and as they celebrate, may they refocus, God, and look to you, God, who is the author and finisher of their faith. God, we pray your continued blessings on them. God, we thank you for the couples that are celebrating, God. We thank you for families, God, and may they, in turn, put you in center, God, of their lives, so that, God, you can be every step of the way with them. God, we give you thanks and we give you praise for what you have done for our celebrants and what you will continue to do, because only you can, God. You are in total control. We give you all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you very much. This past year, we give God thanks for what was accomplished in his service. And you have been very supportive of this, and we want to thank God for you and your continued support prayerfully, morally, financially, and otherwise. As a church, we are excited and passionate about the gospel. We believe that the gospel of Jesus Christ is that which saves, keeps, and ultimately delivers. The gospel spans our entire life. As a matter of fact, from the very beginning of creation, God's intention was always to redeem mankind. The gospel goes beyond "for God so loved the world." And the gospel includes everything that we must know in order to live our lives, and ultimately the life that we will live when we see Christ. As a church, there are three values that are important to us, and we believe that the gospel, number one, must be proclaimed. Number two, the gospel must change you, transform you. And number three, the gospel must be lived out. And so everything that we do as a church is focused towards, one, gospel proclamation; two, gospel transformation; and the gospel in community. We wish to share with you just briefly some clips of what God did this year during our gospel proclamation and our outreach in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ to each of you. And likewise, what the gospel has done in transforming lives and how it has been lived out in community. So we're going to show you these three clips, one after the other, and we pray that it will be a blessing to you. The psalmist says in Psalm 113, "Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, ye servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forever. Every tongue shall confess. Hallelujah. Blessings. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Jesus in the place today. He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of honor. Blessing and honor. Glory and power. Be unto the ancient of days. On every nation. Creation, bow before the ancient of days.
Thank you for those who are joining us today for the first time or you're visiting from overseas. We always like to allow you the opportunity to catch up and to see what we have been doing. So thank you very much. It's been a good year. In everything, we've learned to give thanks, for it is the will of God concerning us. But we are focused on doing the work that God wants us to do. And as pastor of this church, that is my responsibility to keep you focused. As St. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And in all of it, in this year, we want to give God thanks for the great resilience of our people. And you have remained strong and very supportive. You've supported with your time. You've supported with your giving. You've supported with your words of encouragement. You have supported with your presence. And all of that is important for the progress and development of the work. We particularly want to thank our media ministry for the tremendous work that they have done this past year. Both those within the church and those outside of the church. We especially thank Kai Juan. He carries a great weight, and so we want to thank Kai Juan. And now that Deacon Marlon is not with us, Ian does a lot of that kind of work, and we want to thank Ian for his commitment. We thank the entire team, Shanna, for being so committed and so involved in what we do, and we appreciate that very much. We also want to thank our music ministry, and I particularly want to thank all of them for their commitment, but I especially want to thank Sister Dawn for all that she continues to do to grow our music ministry. I know that lots of what has been accomplished would not have happened if it had not been for her. And I say that with great confidence and yet with a sense of pride that we are able to tap into her resources, her networking, and all that she brings to the ministry. I want to give God thanks for our security ministry, and especially Brother Duane. He is not with us today. He traveled to be with his family, and we want to thank God for the work that he has started and those who are a part of the team for the tremendous work that they have been doing. Thank you very much to Brother Julian, who does tremendous work on the building, making sure that everything is in place, and we really appreciate the work that he continues to do. We want to thank Pro Video Productions and Alex St. Just for the contribution that they have made also to the media ministry. We appreciate everyone for the work they continue to do, but there are just a few folks who really stand out, and I wanted to recognize them. Brother Elman Phipps, for the continued maintenance around the church. Thank you very much, Brother Elman. And Sister Marcia, for being an all-arounder and working so well with the children's ministry now that Sister Iselma is on a little sabbatical. We want to thank Sister Marcia for her commitment there. We want to thank Sister Pam for tremendous work with the ushers, and all that she continues to do. Sister Berisia and her team for preparing the sanctuary for the services without fail. You don't have to call them. They sometimes remind me. Once there's something happening at the church, they show up, and we want to thank God for them. We recognize in particular, I want to really, we spoke of it in the media ministry, but Kaijuan is doing a tremendous work with the young people, and I wanted to put that on the record. He has grown very well, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and what I like about him, he has a trainable spirit. He's not like some folks who don't want the pastor to say anything to them. He takes it, he says, yes, pastor, no, pastor, I will do better next time. And boy, I don't have to tell you, you can see it for yourself. You can see the tremendous growth that he demonstrates, and we are really, really proud and happy for that. We want to thank our prayer ministry. Sister Yolenis is not with us today, but at some point we will be with her. And we want to thank them for the continued work that they do. We have since appointed Sister Dahlia to lead our prayer ministry, and we want to commend Sister Dahlia and her team. Our pack in attendance, headed by Pastor Pitt, thank you very much for the work you do on the outside. And to all of you, whatever your role is, whatever part you play, we want to thank you. All of you contribute tremendously, and we thank you. But I must mention those folks because they do tremendous work even in the background. So thank you so very much for what you have done. As we go into the new year, we give God thanks for what he has been doing and what he continues to do. As we focus on the new year, we want to challenge us to continue to focus on prayer as an important element in our life. And as we go through the year, you are going to find around the church that you are going to see this sign, and even in your own personal life, we're going to ask you to just brand it and carry it, this, that you should pray more, you should pray for others, and you should pray persistently. And if you just do that, it will help you in your life. We are going to give you some little magnets that you can put in a visible space that you can have to remind you that you must always pray. No matter whether your prayer is short or long, loud or soft, we want to encourage you to pray, because as I will share with you in the month of January on prayer, prayer comes natural, because when God breathes into man, that word breathe, breath, and prayer is the same thing. And so that is why even Deacon Marlin was able to say that people who may not have expressed openly their faith in Christ, the first thing they talk about is prayer. Because God breathed into man the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And that word, breathe, breath, is the same as prayer. Isn't it amazing? And so that is why there is a tendency for us always to turn to prayer. And those who don't, it's because of what Romans 1 says. When they knew God, they did not want to worship him as God, so they suppressed the truth of God in their life. And if you can make these prayer goals for your life this year, to pray more, I think all of us would agree that we need to pray more. Anybody? Right. And you pray for others. Not just for yourself, you pray for others, and you pray persistently. Pray often, pray intensely, pray intently, pray fervently, passionately. And I believe that as you practice that, and that become a part of you, you will see results in your life. Now, to ensure that we focus on this and continue, we propose next year to create a memorial to honor the life of Sister Eulenice, and we intended to erect a prayer garden and to place a plaque, a nice plaque that, put back the plaque please, that celebrates her life, and it's going to be right here in the back of the church's yard, and nicely done, so you will have the opportunity to come at any time and have a quiet time with God. In that prayer space, we intend to make it really, really nice and inviting, and that again is going to be very costly, but we intend to leave no stones unturned to ensure that it's done nicely not merely for the memory of Sister Eulenice, but because of the emphasis of prayer, and the environment makes a difference. And so we wanted to create something that was living, something that would continue, something that would allow people to engage, and we thought that the best thing to do was to create that prayer garden. And so we are looking forward to unveiling that in the month of March during our church's anniversary celebration. So we are going to put that beautiful plaque, and next week we'll have a 3D image of what the prayer garden is going to look like. That wasn't completed in time, but we're going to have a beautiful 3D image of that. And so if Sister Eulenice has been a blessing in your life and you want to have a tangible part in this, I'm going to ask you to see me personally. You are not required to, you are not being forced to, you're not being told to. If you feel that you want to have a part in this, that she has had a part in your life and you want to have a tangible part in it, then I'm going to ask you to actually see me. Outside of that, we are going to pursue that as a church. And then I want us to focus on our growth path as we continue to grow in Jesus Christ. And in our growth path, we continue to proclaim the gospel so we can win disciples for Jesus. Amen. The purpose of the church is to create disciples. And discipleship is hard work. Jesus walked with his disciples, and it came down to 12 in the end. They didn't start as 12, had hundreds, and then it dwindled down to 12. Because disciples have to live with you. They have to experience you. They have to see what life is like, and it rubs you down. And can you imagine how many times Jesus had to give Peter a scuff? I would imagine there were days when Jesus had to give Peter a scuff. Jesus was so fed up of Peter one time, he said, "Satan, you see?" And so the church is supposed to win disciples. So sometimes in the church, we get all bent out of shape. But the church should bend you out of shape. You to win disciples. You can't be in the church and just be comfortable, and it doesn't work that way. You will be offended, but you have to know how to deal with your offense. The church's covenant says, slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure it without delay. And so our focus is to continue to win disciples for Jesus, not for the Antioch Baptist Church, but for the kingdom of heaven. And through this church, we can be a blessing and a conduit. We are God's glory, his power, and his blessings can flow towards them. But if you focus on the kingdom and focus on God, you will dig roots and you will grow in Christ. Don't merely focus on the church. That won't help you. You'll get fed up sooner rather than later. But if you focus on the kingdom, if you focus on building the kingdom of Jesus, you will hang in there. This past year has been a great year, and I say to folks all the time, there have been many opportunities when I could have said, I'm done. I've had enough of these people. I'm done. I could move on with my life. I don't have to be doing this. I don't need to take this pressure. I'm done. But you know what? I know why I do this. And the day that the Lord is ready for me to be done. See, Sister Tisha here. Excuse me, Tisha. I always remember this, so I have to say this. Many years ago, when Tisha was the secretary of our church, many, many moons ago, and we were having a discussion one time, something we were talking about, I never forgot this. And I don't remember what caused this to come up, but I remember her saying this. She said, Pastor Lincoln, this is the kind of person you are. You will never leave anything undone. And if you are moving on, you will make sure you complete the task, you inform the people appropriately, and then you move on. And you will never move until there's a replacement. Always remember that. It's amazing how words have power. Always remember that. And so in my own life, you can be sure. You can be sure. You will never wake up one morning and hear me say, I quit. Never. Never. When the Lord's time is right, he will give me enough signal from heaven so that the church can continue appropriately. And I want us to understand this, that your role is to be committed to the vision. Yes, sir. In as much as the leaders of our church and your lead pastor is committed to the task of ensuring that you grow in Christ and not placating or relinquishing my responsibilities, but ensuring that I do the best that I can. Your responsibility is to pray and support in every way you possibly can. And if you agree with me, say amen. Thank you very kindly. So as we win disciples for Jesus, we want to invest everything that we have in growing them for God. Invest the word of God. Invest whatever resources personally, whatever we can invest. And as I said to the 7 o'clock worshipers, I said, I say this with a great sense of humility, but any person who's walked through the door of the Antioch Baptist Church at any time in their life and spend any considerable amount of time here, you are better off. None of you can say you are worse off because you're part of this church. 100% all of you are better off. Many things in your life, you have it because of this church. The church has encouraged you. The church has inspired you. In cases, we have held your hands. Many of you, you have higher education because the church has encouraged it. Many of you have a home, you have property, you have a business because you heard something from the pulpit which inspired you and challenged you. Many of you, your children are better off because the church has invested in you. You are better off 100%. You should be better off financially because we have only invested in you. We have not taken anything from you. We have encouraged you to be financially prudent and to do all that you can to ensure that you live a wholesome life. And if you are not better, it's because you have chosen not to be. Thank you, Sister Tracy. Only you want to agree with me. I really thought we would have gotten a real round of applause for that. But those are the things I talk about. We just take it for granted because we really do. But I pray that in the new year, that the Lord would heighten your awareness and your senses to what he's trying to do in your own life. And I ask you to pray for me. I covet your prayers because the truth is, all that I want is to see people grow. That's all I want. I want you to grow in every sphere of your life. And growth is hard. And I want to commit and tell you this. I don't intend to change. I can't change. I want you to grow, and growth is hard. And we are going to push you because you need to grow. If you can't deal with that, then I can't do anything to help you. But you need to grow. And all that we will do is continue to encourage you in that growth. Now, having said that, we also today collect our special Catch the Vision offering. And I want to share with you about that just now because our ushers will be coming through the aisle with our forms. And then we are going to collect our offerings. We'll have two testimonies and we'll be on our way. Now, if you did receive one of our pledge forms, we want you to fill this out. If you didn't get one, our ushers should give you one. Every year, you have assisted us in making a capital pledge. This capital pledge has nothing to do with your regular tithe and offerings. And I encourage the 7 o'clock worshipers, please, don't say things like the pastor likes a lot of money. I find it offensive for congregants and people who benefit from this church. As your pastor, I find it very offensive. I don't want your money. I've never asked you to do anything for me. And I never asked you to do anything that I don't do myself. I take nothing from you, and I'm not pastoring you to get your money. I often feel so burdened for people who work for minimum wage and all those things. I see some of our congregants selling trays. And let me tell you something. When people sell a tray in a small shop and put your offering in every week, that is a sacred trust. I can't put my hand in the offering plate and take out your money to go buy a pair of shoes. That's a sacred trust. And I know that you have made a commitment. Whatever you gave to this church goes right back where it belongs. And I want to make that abundantly clear. So every year we ask you to make a capital pledge because it's necessary. If we don't do this, we will not be able to meet all of our commitments. But one of the things that is important as we make this capital pledge, we never ask you, we never tell you how much you should give. We only ask you to give cheerfully, willingly, and regularly. You will make a pledge to one, either the media ministry or Turnaround Agenda or our building facility program. In addition, we have our Gideon 300, which is $30 per month, and that goes again into our facilities and the work that we do. You can decide to contribute to all, or you can choose which one the Lord is leading your heart to contribute towards. But we want as many of you as possible to make this commitment and to fulfill this commitment, as it helps us to continue the work, especially in the media ministry, to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to others. At this juncture, I want to thank those who give online. There are many of you who listen to service and you give online, and we want to thank you very much for that. And there are many across the length and breadth of this country who send checks or cash or whatever it is to support this ministry, and we want to thank you very much for all that you do and continue to do. The reason why we do what we do is because we believe in what we do. And I want you to also believe in what we do. And to believe in those you invest your resources in. I am mindful of one brother who is now deceased, who said to me one day, he said, "Pastor, if it's the last money that I have and the church wants it, I will give it. Because I know that if I come and I ask for bread," note he said bread, "if I come and I ask for bread, you will give it to me." And Sister Diana is our church treasurer, and Sister Diana knows this. And anybody who's worked with me should know my heart. Sister Diana knows this. My first responsibility is to make sure that if there is a need, the need is taken care of. What I tell you, I practice. If we don't have the resources to pay electricity, and somebody has a need, no electricity gonna pay. We will fulfill the need, and later we'll deal with the electricity. Because I fundamentally believe that the church is a community, and how we operate in this community demonstrates the love of God. So thank you for your giving. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your commitment in this regard. The ushers are going to wait on us, and as they wait, you can put your offerings in, your regular offerings, your Christmas offerings, your pledge forms, and anything else. Those of you who have online, if you go on the app, ABCSKN, you can fill that form right there on the app, and you can also give on the app. Or you can go to our website, www.antiochbaptistskn.org. You can fill the form there, and you can also contribute there. So those of you who would wish to do it online, you don't need to submit the paper form today, but please go online and submit, and we will get that information delivered to us. As the ushers wait, we are going to sing, "O Come All You Faithful and Angels We Have Heard on High." Place your pledge information in the basket along with your regular offerings for today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Well, it's good to see you all here. So I will just give a brief overview of what the youth has done this past year and what we plan to do next year. So for a general introduction, I'm the president of the Antioch Baptist Church Amplify Youth. We meet every Friday at 5, and if there is no youth, we would send out a message. So if you don't see a message, we're still having youth Fridays at 5. So our mission is to call young people to a dynamic life in Christ. Simple as that, you live it out every day. Now, we have a theme scripture, 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 12, which says, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example to the believers in conversation, charity, the spirit, faith, and purity." So not only I know that, so every member of the youth knows that. We go over there every Friday. It's a part of the devotion, so if you see them, you could ask them and expect them to recite it right in front of you. So just what would happen on Friday? So you would have the general devotions, and in the devotion, we would read the covenant. So just an overview of what the covenant is. It's a pact between you personally and the members of the youth group. So the covenant basically is telling you, well, not telling you, but it's giving you guidelines on how to act, carry yourself, not only in the church, but outside. Outside meaning when you're in the street or you're just walking around. And it also places some level of responsibility on you, because you can't say you're a part of the youth and then do this. And I think the third paragraph, if I remember correctly, it tells us that you want to treat each member of the youth group how you expect it to be treated. So no foul play is expected within this youth group. And at the bottom, as you can see on the screen, now below that you would have an area to sign and date. So we're taking this thing seriously. You put your name and your date and you sign it. Mine has been signed already. So I have some expectations on me and a responsibility to uphold what's in the covenant. And I do plan on doing that. So what we did this past year in early January, so we had an outline and would have followed it along the course of the year despite the disruptions. So we have a leadership course, and in that course we were able to define leadership. And as you could see, you a leader, just simple terms for everybody to understand what a leader is, what do they do, and the goals. And it wasn't just a lecture, you would have some activities between there. And within those activities, it was you trusting your group members. I remember that one specifically. It was a funny one. So you're on a cloth right there, all the members, and then what would happen is you would have some members of the group on the outside. However, you have to listen to them and your feet can't come off the cloth. What you have to do, while all the members on, no feet touching the floor around you, you have to flip it. So let's say you have a two-sided table, green on one side, orange on the other side, and you're standing on the orange side. You have to flip it over to the green side without putting your foot on the floor. It was a pretty hard exercise, I'm not gonna lie. Good thing I wasn't leading. I couldn't get it done, trust me. And it was perfect, because within that, you're able to see new leaders emerge and different people taking over, and they're doing things, and you're like, oh, may not I could do that. And you just bond the members of the group, and you create some trust between them. And also what we had, another exercise, it was where you had two people. One, they had some writing on a card. Let's say you had to draw a dog eating ice cream. That was actually one. And then you had a draw. So the person who drawing, they don't know what they're drawing at all. They know they're supposed to draw a dog eating ice cream. So what ended up happening is they would have to listen to the other person, give them instructions, and you would just have to trust them. But it's only one person speaking. The rest members of the group, they cannot say anything, but they all know what's supposed to happen. So for people who don't keep the mouth shut when they're supposed to, that's when your time was supposed to happen. And it was a good very good learning thing. I didn't, again, trust me, in something everybody could do. And that is exactly why we had this course, so you could see different people have different areas to grow in and improve in. And that's exactly what we do here at the youth, and that's something that we're very proud of. Now, speaking of growth, one thing I would love to mention, and I will mention it, is the growth in the youth members. Initially, when we started out, they were afraid to speak, they were afraid to pray. Nevertheless, I still continued and we work with them. And with that being said, there has been some growth, and as small things like when you pick up the offering, you pray over it, there would be some resistance. First of all, you think a prayer is supposed to be long to be good, you have to use big words. No, it was none of that. You had to do some coaching between there, and you told them about, okay, it's just a simple thing. Before we get to that, we did the Acts prayer model. So basically what that is, you had adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. So in that, that's the general prayer model that we taught to them. So it would be a bit easier for them to pray. And you all could use it as well, because some people, they don't know how to pray. And they're afraid they might say the wrong thing or they might sound stupid. And so what would end up happening is they don't want to do it at all, and it creates a fear. So that model is just a general way for you to step forward and dip your foot in the water to get accustomed to praying, because you could spend 5 minutes on confession, 20 minutes on thanksgiving, because you do have a lot to give thanks for. We made it through a very, very hard year, and we're still living. So just something as simple as that. And for those who wondering, supplication is the asking. That's why you ask God for things, and there's a reason why it's last. Because you can't ask for everything, and you don't need everything that you ask for. Thank you. And what we also did this year, which ended up tying into something that we are going to do next year, we've done a plumbing model with the young men. I mentioned that we did it last year, and we got through it despite the challenges. And so during that plumbing module, you were taught simple things like using a tape measure, because it's plumbing, you have the young men there. And in the first class, what we did, it was just, okay, so what you expect to learn? And most of this stuff was like household things that we wanted to do, because you're home, you see something leaking and you want to fix it. You can't just stand up there, and in all the time you want your mom call somebody, being honest. Sometimes you all feel like, I want to do this myself, and you feel proud about it. So simple things like tape, using how to use a tape measure, how to read it properly, and also sticking PVC pipe. I feel very, very proud of myself that I know a pipe cleaner is, and I could use cement on it. So thank you. Yes, not only me, but as you can see, many young men out there, they did it and they did well. So that was in a later part of it. Now what that is showing you, that's some rainwater harvesting systems. Anybody familiar with that? No? Okay, good. So what that is you use the rainwater, or you collect the rainwater in a jug or a barrel, if you don't want to buy it, and you would be able to use it in your house to water your garden, wash. You could treat it if you want to cook with it and do the extra mile, but it basically takes a chunk out of your water bill if you use that a lot. And that is something that we taught them, so we're also promoting environmental sustainability in this church also. And we had the TAG Young Men's Conference that was November gone, which was very, very successful. And it was very nice to see all of them come out. And first day, it was a decent amount, and then the second day, it increased again, and then the third day. So even though you didn't make it the first day, you still had more people coming in. So it's not just a one-off, and they do look forward to it. And also, that entire conference, the theme was Behind the Mask. And so you had Unmasking Your Potential, Unmasking Generational Wealth, as Pastor would have mentioned this morning, that you are able to, somebody blessed you, and then you reach your position now where you could give back to your children. And you may not see it, but later down in the line, 50, 20 years, who knows, you might own a building in town got a whole section named after you, all that involved. And we learned things, especially in Unmasking Generational Wealth. This one I liked in particular, that you learned about buying land and how land increases, it's an appreciating value, as the fancy term goes, and things like cars are depreciating value. Appreciating meaning you gain value over time, depreciating meaning you lose value over time. And so things like that we learn, and how to spend money wisely. I mean, you're young, you get money, you're not working, people give you money because you're young, and we learn how to spend it properly and manage it properly, most importantly. And at some point we did have a physical component, as you seen on the screen, that was in the third there, and we had some help there. It was very good to get out and warm your body instead of just sitting down for the past 2 days and just hearing people speak really and truly, because it's bars, I'm being honest. You can't sit down in a class for too long. You want to go outside and do something. And so this was good. I enjoyed it. Everybody else enjoyed it. And also, which is something you don't often hear of, we did have some members who were baptized from the youth group. And that is something I am very proud of, because you don't just commute because you ain't have nothing to do. You commute because we're trying to get you to a closer relationship with God. That is the purpose. The grown people come to church, the younger people come to youths. Same thing, different bus you've taken. So we also have an entrepreneurship course. Now, big word, entrepreneurship, your businesses, you're building your businesses, you see businesses in town, oh, I want to start a business, I don't know how. So we're doing all of that in the entrepreneurship course. You teaching them how to start up your business, what to do, things, expenditure, budget, all sorts of things like that. And things like these you don't find in other churches, or they won't really teach you that in school. You might hear it in a passing and you ain't hear it again for the rest of your life until you go out and then you hit hardness and then you can't pick yourself up. And it's not as linear, meaning the discussion, what I was talking about, it's not as linear as it happened. But of course you had COVID and then we had the lockdown. Now, between that period when we had the lockdown, we were able to do some distribution of food hampers to some of the members. And as you can see, your money goes back to you and it's not just staying here and being collected. And things like these, are situations like that, is why you should give to the church, because it never stays here, it always goes back to you. And that's for everybody out there. And what we did with the rainwater harvesting, now, they did the plumbing, but we also did something. During that time, we were shooting some films and we plan to release them next year. And I will now just show you a short clip of each. The same groups from the Christmas play, mind you, they did their own version of the rainwater harvesting system, and you have different interpretations of it. So we'll now display the clips on the screen for you. Okay, so each group, they had their own thing, I apologize. But that's basically it. So we would...
Bye guys, the next...
Okay, so I'm just let her on for a short time and then I would explain afterwards. Go ahead. Okay, so we're going to skip over that.
Bye guys, the next week.
Thank you. Okay, so next year, in addition to releasing these clips, what we plan to do is have some other engagements other than Sunday morning you come. We would have some for the youth and other activities so you could see them, instead of just if you happen to pass by on a Friday, you would be able to engage them in other ways and see them on live. And all of that is what we plan to do next year. And thank you all. And we would like to ask you to continue to support the youth and continue to lift them up. If you see them, please greet them kindly. We don't know what's happening. It's not a pity thing, but it's young people. You need encouragement. Sometimes the home life is not too well. Just a little, hey, how you doing? You all right? Long time ain't see you. That would help along the way. And so that's all we'd like to ask for your continued support, and thank you.
Everybody singing, hallelujah.
Thank you very kindly. We want to give thanks to God for Brother Kaijuan and the report and these young people and the work that they are doing. We give God thanks. Amen. Amen. I pray that God has spoken to your heart in so many different ways. It was a service with many moving parts, and I am sure that there was something that was said or done that the Holy Spirit will use to impact your life. And we want to pray God's continued blessings upon your life as you go forth into the remaining days of this week and into the new year, if God is so gracious and merciful to allow us to see a new year. We want to pray God's blessings upon you. Well, I'm really excited about what God is doing and what God can do in your life. And just to change your mind by the power of God's Holy Spirit and let God resonate in your hearts. And deep down in your soul, you get a new dispensation of God's grace, and you will see how you will be different. It is nothing that is just mere magical. There is a part of our Christian walk which is called sanctification, and that's the hard part. God's Holy Spirit will work with us, but there are things that we have to do. There is nothing we can do to be accepted by God, but God is not going to beat you to pray. And sanctification includes our relationship, our communication with God. It includes understanding the fruits of the Spirit that are here. And thanks, Sister Shabina, again at the end of the year for producing those for us. Those of you who haven't yet gotten your fruits of the Spirit, and if you are new to us, this is what happens at the end of the year. We give you a fruit of the Spirit. You allow the Holy Spirit to direct you to choose one. And that particular fruit that you choose will be what the Holy Spirit will work on you for the year. And those of you who have been part of it, it's been a blessing, hasn't it? And if you really focus on it, even when you don't focus, but you just know what your fruit is, sometimes you operate in that fruit, and then you come and you realize that, wow, this is really what God has been doing in my heart. And so before we leave, make sure you get yours, that is the fruit of the Spirit the Lord wants to work on you for next year. And every testimony has demonstrated where we were lacking, that's the fruit that the Lord gave us. And so please do take one before you leave and let God's Holy Spirit work in your life. There is no greater joy, says John, than to see my children walk in truth. And we want you to walk in the truth and in the light of God's word. So let us then stand to our feet at this time. And we are going to ask our associate pastor, Pastor Keithley, to come and dismiss us. And then we are going to sing while shepherds watch their flocks by night. We want to give God thanks for all those of you who've come from overseas to share in this experience. DJ Dre, he came out, Carolyn, with us, and his wife Giselle. Thank you so very much for being with us. We appreciate that. And we are glad to see the Philip brothers. I think Tama goes back today. Today, yes, he just had a week, and we give God thanks for them. And that is why this foundation is important, because wherever they go, Colossians chapter 1 says, this gospel will bear fruit throughout the world. And because they have been given that foundation, wherever they go, they will live out that faith. As a doctor, when he sees the operating room and he sees that the faith is going to come back to him. And I'm very proud of our young people that even though they go out, when they come back into the house of the Lord. And we are really excited for them and continue to pray for them, as Kaijuan said, even those who do not yet know what it shall be. But they need that encouragement, they need that prayer. We bring young people to our youth from right around the island. On Friday nights, we go right around the island, right around the island. And we are so excited. We have a young man who comes from Sandy Point, and he says, my friend and everything say, why you had to go all the way tongue to go church? He said, Pastor, I tell them, I don't understand what others get. That's why I got to leave Sandy Point and come church up here. And it was Kaijuan who invited him, and we are excited that these young people are inviting their friends, because you only invite them when something good is happening. And so we want to thank God for them, thank God for their life, thank God for everything, and we just are so excited about their future and continue to pray for them. and be a blessing to them as much as you are able to. Amen. All right, so I feel really good today. Very, very good today. And remember Brother Deacon Marlon and Sister Jem in your continued prayers. Sister Jem is smiling, puts on a good face, but of course, you know, the challenges, the pain, it must be real, you know what I'm saying? And so just remember them in our prayers. And Ethan and all the dynamics that are involved in that. Continue to pray for Sister Eulenice's family. I think when we lost Sister Eulenice, we lost a tremendous, tremendous part of our work. And Sister Eulenice was a critical, integral part of our church. I personally miss her because she was very dear to me in terms of what needed to be done in the background. And we have not discovered anybody in the church as yet like Sister Eulenice, but we continue to pray and ask God to raise up other servants who are going to be faithful to him. And I think as we go and you reflect, as I said to us, that God works in time and he has a big picture as to why he's doing what he's doing. You could ask multiple questions, and I told somebody, I said to God, God, I could have given you 10 people you could have killed. 10 you could take and just leave Eulenice. And that may sound humorous to you, but you know, only when you're in certain situations, you talk to God a certain way, and I'm glad you've never been in them kind of situations. Just where Sister Eulenice was and just how the Lord just took her away, I don't think that we could wrap our minds around it. And I think it should cause us to draw even closer to the Lord and live more for him. But as I said to you, my last encounter with Sister Eulenice in this hallway at the end of August, it just said to me that she felt like there was something she had to do and to complete, and she would never come back into this space. And when I say to us, whenever we are leaving this space, this may be our last, we take it for granted. And when I say to you, when you come to this space, commit. Don't leave home, no part you have to go to. Commit. Commit. You don't know what God is doing. Trust every moment in your life that God is doing something that you totally do not understand. And give every moment of your life over to the Lord. You have absolutely no idea what God is doing. It may not be your last. You may continue to live, but it might be the last time you had the opportunity to impact that person. It might be the last words you said to them. You don't know. Let God's Holy Spirit use you in your life. Thank you so very much, Brother Hanley, for being here. And Kai Jana, as he celebrates his birthday tomorrow. Again, he is in school, and his sister is going shortly. And so many of our young people are moving out. Let's just continue to pray for them, that God will cover them as they go into a foreign land. Andrean left this year. She's in Morocco. And all of these countries that were just on the atlas, these young people are experiencing them. It is a wonderful thing. And I always remembered what Hassani said to me when he came here. He said, when I sat in this church when we were in Infirmary Road, and he said, I saw how all these young people were going away to study. He was just a little boy in first form. He said, I want that for me too. And that is the work of the church, to inspire and for them to know that their work matters to God. They may not stand in this pulpit like I do, but their work matters to God. Wherever they find themselves, they must be light and salt. And their work matters to God. We thank God for the godly heritage legacy of this church. And we thank God for those who blaze the trail. And those of you who are here, your responsibility is to enshrine your name on the hearts of those who you leave behind. Many of you talk about the impact that Sister Eulenice had on your life, but my question is, what impact are you having on somebody else's life? How do they know you? Do they know you as a burden bearer? Do they know you as an encourager? Do they know you as a confusion? Do they know you as an upstart? Do they know you as a disgruntled person? What impact are you making on their life? And I pray that God would speak to us, even as we continue on for him. Pastor Kilty, would you come and dismiss us at this time, and then we'll sing our closing song. Amen.
Shall we pray? God, we've had a great time in your presence. We thank you, God, that from the beginning to the end, you have been with us. Your presence, God, overshadowed us. And so, God, our hearts are full. Thank you, God, for bringing us here this morning, even as we celebrate the incarnate Son, him who came into the world to save sinners, him who came unto a people who did not believe in him. And so, God, he has given us in this current time the opportunity to know him as Savior. And so, God, we give you thanks. We continue, God, to give you thanks for our lead pastor as he continues to shepherd this flock that you have put into his care. We pray, Holy God, that you would continue to inspire him. We pray, Holy God, that you would continue to lift him up. We pray, God, that you will continue to keep your hand upon him for good, so that, dear God, we may follow him as he follow you. And so for all of us who are gathered here this morning, dear Father, we could have been elsewhere, but through the presence of your Holy Spirit, we are here this morning. And Father, we give you thanks. And so, God, as we separate one from the other, and you pray, God, that you will take us to homes in safety, we pray, God, that our hearts and our minds will continue to reflect upon you and upon who you are. And throughout this day, dear God, we will continue to have conversations with ourselves of how good and gracious you are. And so, God, we pray that you may dismiss us now with your choicest blessings. For we pray in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. While shepherds watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground, the official service on Friday night begins at 10:30. Prayer begins at 7 while shepherds watch.